Good day, live from the University of Technology in Eindhoven. My name is Rudy. I will be your moderator today. So please swing on those cameras if you are in the live call, obviously. We've got 45 minutes ahead of us for the very first Boost interview, and it's a pleasure for me hosting it, and as well with my first guest. And I hope you've got like 1,000+ questions for her. But first and foremost, I ask you kindly to swing on that camera, to unmute yourself, and to get your hands together loudly. All of you, get your hands together for Maaike Reijsenburg! Hey! Excellent, Maaike, welcome. Is your Hello. Yeah? There you are. You can also see them on the screen, definitely.
Yeah.
Welcome. It's just a short drive, but you've been all over the country already today.
Yeah, that's true, actually.
Quite a busy day, isn't it?
Yeah, but that's normal in a startup or a scale up.
Scale up, actually, it now is.
Yeah.
Because in the preparation, one of the people was asking already, was she there from the very start in 2016? Not quite, because that was also the year you were graduating here at university, wasn't it?
That is true, yeah. Actually, just like the founders. And I got the opportunity to be there from the start. You could say I made a mistake or the right decision not to do it in the beginning. Because I thought that I first had to gain some more experience and more knowledge at a consultancy company, where I later on could apply it to a startup or a scale-up. So I did. And actually, I spent a half a year at a consultancy company while sometimes participating in brainstorms or that kind of stuff at Leitcher back then. And after half a year, I decided that the half year consultancy company actually learned me that working experience was maybe less of importance for me at that moment than the right motivation and drive and an honest self-reflection. I think that's important too. To just start at Leitcher and see what happens. And so I started as a second employee, so I can still say I was there from the beginning, looking at the numbers.
Yeah. So you were person number 7 yourself.
Yeah, I was number 7. Mm-hmm. Yeah, indeed. Yeah, and now we have 300 people, so quite some change.
Yeah, we will dive into that first, but maybe because we jump right into it, Leitcher, what are we talking about? Like one of the first world's production solar cars. And it comes from the student team that participated in the World Solar Challenge many, many years in a row, did the run in Australia, won many, many prizes, and then the 5 founders of Leitcher at the automotive campus in Helmond right now, they decided, let's build a production car out of it.
Yeah.
And that's actually the journey, and there's so much to tell about that, but today we will focus on a specific topic as well for the startup companies that are joining us right now, and that's on the organizational structure and as well as the high performing teams. And that's all because, Maaike, you are the chief people and processes officer. That's a mouthful. Did you think 5 years ago that you would ever have a title like that?
No, and I never thought I would work for an automotive company at all, actually. And it has had several titles, so it was called Chief Growth or Organization, and then over time it's changed because the titles were used for different purposes, like the COO is something really different at the automotive company than I was doing there. So yeah, it was Chief People Process Officer. For me, it's just a title.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hey, and we will dive into the organizational structure, and obviously people can ask us questions by the chat or later on by unmuting themselves. But maybe to start off with you as a person, you were employee number 2. What motivates you? Is it the job titles? Is it the company car? Is it salary? What is your fuel for your engine?
Yeah, that's a nice one, because actually today I was asked the same question for a video we are about to make at Leitcher, because we turn 5 this November. And then I was thinking about it, what is it? And I mean, in the beginning, it was especially the freedom to actually achieve something, and I really like to work, actually. I like to spend time on organizing stuff and achieving something. And I thought, okay, then if I spend so much time of my daily work into something, then better be something good.
True.
And I was driven a lot by the purpose of Leitcher, because I like the idea that you do not like take away something from people because of sustainability perspective, but you provide an alternative which is way more sustainable, and therefore you can provide value to more people while having a good world in the end as well.
Definitely.
So that was what motivated me in the beginning and what motivates me still, of course. But what was added to it is the people working for Lightyear and at Lightyear. It's just such a great group of people that, yeah, I really like to work with, and that keeps me enthusiastic and energized.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Awesome, cool, and that's a good thing as being the chief people, yeah. The better
might
like or love people, indeed.
Yeah.
You are still very young, and you graduated 5 years ago. You have a bachelor in industrial design and then a master in innovation management.
Yeah.
Maybe you've been in this very building as well,
yeah,
before they
yeah.
redone it, actually. Now it looks very fancy and
yeah.
cool, obviously. But what I'm willing to ask is that I did saw some footage that you were at this very huge congress with all these business people, and then there was the question being put out on the solar car that the student team worked with.
Yeah.
Why did they always win? While everyone had the good cars, the good financing power, like from all these student teams, they were all like similarly good.
Yeah.
And still Eindhoven won a lot of prizes. And
yeah.
then you had to answer that question. Do you remember what you answered?
Yeah, I do. I think I don't know exactly what I said, but probably it will be something that was in the culture and the way they optimized on the whole product. So they were able actually to sometimes take a step back in order to serve the bigger goal. And that is the approach that helps you optimize on the total performance of the car instead of individual parts.
Yeah.
And that's something that we apply to the car nowadays as well as the organization as a whole. It's not just the product, but it's
so a little bit more bluntly put, in a nutshell, is that the founders, each of them, put their own big egos aside in order
yeah.
for their solo car to thrive.
Yeah, and that, not only the founders, but it was just the whole solar team back then. Yeah, so it was something, it was a kind of culture. It might be a bit Dutch as well. We call it polderen, right? That you that you try to get
Seek
somewhere in between all the different opinions. Sometimes that's hard as well, because it can result in long discussions, long meetings. But I think the end result was there, and it showed the world that did lead to 4 times winning the World Solar Challenge. So
awesome. Yeah. And we will get to the organizational structure, and maybe you can tell us a little bit more about it, because this is all new to me. Like, I'm accompanied by one myself, so it's kind of flat in my case. But whenever you do such a solar race, it's super obvious what the goal is, like being the quickest, to winning something.
Yeah.
And another part of the topic laying on table right now is high-performing teams.
Yeah.
But what's your perspective on that, or how can we in this very setting define high performance teams? Is it whenever they work flat out? Is it selling as much cars as possible? What should be indicators?
Yeah, that is a good, I think in general a goal of course helps, but I've been doing some research while working at Lightyear. I think it's not comparable to doing research at the university, but at least short breaks of research. And what I noticed is that if you read books like Drive by Daniel Pink or Engagement Magic, they all refer back to some main aspects that lead, in their opinion, to a good performance of an organization. And usually that is aspects like having a purpose, giving autonomy, and making sure that people can master their skills and become better at it. And I think, you can write down a list of maybe 3 to 5 of these aspects. And I think that usually in companies, stuff is blocking this kind of way of work. So you have politics, or people working there for a longer period, they don't want to change, or they don't want to give autonomy to other people, whatever reason. And I think it's actually super easy to build a company, because these are really simple building blocks.
Sentence, yeah. Isn't it? It's rather easy to build a company.
I must say it's clear how you should do it, but it might be hard to execute it. But I think that if you just apply those principles, and I think that would be my main advice, to really set up these principles for yourself. It can be partly general, and it can be partly adjusted for your own company and your own vision. Personally, I then believe that you at least have the right foundation to make sure you have a high performing company or team in general.
All right.
Yeah.
Well, Mike is throwing a stone in the pond right now, so maybe we can bounce it back to the audience. It's rather easy or quite simple to come up with the structure for a company. Is there someone willing to respond? Someone daring to ask a question on that? Please feel free to unmute yourself and simply ask.
Yeah, so I was wondering how did you start with your company structure? I mean, did you look at what similar other companies did and then copy that, or did you just invented it on your own?
Both, I think. I think it's funny because we already started quite early on trying to define some kind of structure. I think already when we were about 10 people. And I think it started with having some research on what other companies indeed do. So we had the Spotify model, for example, or the holacracy methodology that you see, which is more about organic growth of companies. And that was something that we liked a lot because it was based on flat structures and high levels of autonomy. And at the same time, I think we were inspired by the student teams as well, because of course they had quite big teams as well, about I think 20 to 30 people. So that requires quite some structure too. And they have defined the structure based on the on a system perspective. So they look at the product from a holistic system perspective and then have a logical breakdown into the different systems that correspond to it. So we still try, because that is a challenge to get this combination. On the one hand, having a more hierarchical structure, which is based on the system of the product, and on the other hand, allowing for autonomy, flexibility, a flat structure, which allows to at least discuss with everybody, make your own decisions, that kind of stuff. But I think that the first one is more linked indeed to the car, and it gives clarity on what we are building and who's responsible for what. And the second thing, it's more in the culture. So even if we would draw a rather hierarchical way of our organization structure, which we actually don't do, but if we would, then it's in the culture that actually makes sure that we are operating as a flat organization. Because it's in the behavior more than in a drawing, right?
Yeah.
Even if you draw a flat hierarchy, but you have high levels of hierarchy in your organization, then you'll notice.
Yeah.
And can I ask you another question? So do you still have the same structure today with 300 people that you had when you were 30?
No, not at all. I think we have shifted already for 3 times. And we are about to shift again because we started the year with 120 people. Now we were 300. And we do notice some cracks and challenges in the organization structure at this moment.
Like what?
Yeah, you notice that you get more islands, for example, mm-hmm. or the integration is not done logically, or people tend to get too big teams, which doesn't allow them to have a personal interaction with the people in their teams. Mm-hmm. And we value that a lot. So we notice that the structure is blocking our values, and then we have to redesign. And now we need to figure out whether it's just parts of the organization or the organization as a whole, and whether it's the structure or the way of work. Because it could be that the structure might stay the same, but that we change our way of work in, for example, a more agile way. It's something that we apply in some teams, but not as a general way of work, because we wanted to give the autonomy. But it might shift that we will require people to get a more consistent way of work together to make sure that the alignment is there without adjusting on the structure.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Bernice. And you're nuancing already that it can be in the structure or maybe in the way of working.
Yeah.
And you also indicated that you have shifted a few times already.
Yeah.
How's the feedback from employees? Are people saying out loud, I quit, I don't want to work in this company anymore? Or will they say, finally, something has been done about it?
I think both can happen, even though at this moment we did not have many people that quit their jobs, which I think it's fine if people quit their jobs. It should just not be too high. So we support people that want to work elsewhere. We even have people that started elsewhere and then came back quite some, actually. I think about maybe 15 people or some that came back again. And what I am actually most proud on is that We have just hired 180 people in 7 months. And of those 180 people, I am at least what I'm aware of, and I think it's more or less all, we have, I think, one or two people that left the company because it just did not turn out the way that they expected it to be.
Oh, wow.
And I think that's great because we are able to show to the external world what we are.
Actually, yeah, what you are, yeah. And there's no mismatch, yeah, in the expectations they have. So that's, yeah, like 1% of the people that,
yeah,
left.
Even less, I think. Yeah,
yeah, even less than, yeah, that. Yeah,
yeah, so that is nice. And we use a culture scan. So we have a quarterly questionnaire where we ask a lot of feedback from the people at Lightyear. So we are quite aware of what's going well and not so well. And they know that we take their feedback seriously.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. All right. Well, in this case, we've got several startups over here in the Teams call, obviously. And they are teams a little bit smaller than 300 people, and most of the names do fit in my small little note over here.
Yeah.
But can you imagine when they think we're focusing on the technology of our product or the software instead, we don't have any time for the way of working or the structure of the organization. What would be your, yeah, message to people like that if they would be in the call, yeah, at the moment?
Well, I actually really like to discuss about more of the early stages of Lightyear because it is such an effective way of work, right? You still know everybody in the team. You have clear ideas on what works and what doesn't work for people, how you should communicate to people in your team and just have discussions together. So it's super effective. I think adding people to a company, of course, helps you achieve new goals, but it adds a lot of complexity too. And what I always said already back then is that we are not only building a car, but we were building a company as well. And it has to be in parallel, because otherwise, yeah, we'll have a car, but if we are not able to serve the car, to sell the car, to build the car, to whatever, then we can have a nice design, but that doesn't,
yeah,
make sense.
Yeah.
So, and there's this really nice video that you might search for. It's I'm not sure about the title, but it's something like building a plane in the air, which refers to a plane that's being built in the air and people are served there while taking a flight and still have to steer the plane, and it's just everything at once. And I think that's the kind of feeling that you might have already and that you will experience in the future as well, about that you are selling your product, still building your product, still finding the people that actually have to build the product because you don't have them yet, and everything just comes in once. And yeah, that's the best feeling of working at a startup.
Not entirely. I have to refer to this morning when I was hosting a webinar like this, and I felt like that with new people popping in and new slides flying around.
Yeah.
But that is actually a very good takeaway, because you and Lex, your CEO, indicated on the Congress as well. So we are not only building a car, we're actually also building a team.
Yeah.
And what you also added back then was we're also building a market,
yeah,
like for people, for customers, yeah, to be ready to adopt,
yeah,
our, yeah, innovation, actually.
Yeah, that is true.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Any responses by people in the call? Would you like to respond on this or question Maaike? Feel free.
Maaike, you talked about you know, you had set up with a small group of presumably fellow students.
Yeah.
I was just interested, you know, how you progress from that, you know, enthusiastic group of engineers, I'm assuming most are, to a, you know, to a commercial business. So that you, I guess some of those students may not have had the finance background, the sales and marketing background, but they would have. So what's the next stage, and how many founders did you actually have?
Yeah, so we have 5 founders, and they were actually actively supported by one of the strategic advisors who has a clear view on what's needed in an organization. So I think that helped a lot in the beginning. So we clearly had someone being responsible for finance, for strategy, for commerce. So it was clearly defined. And I think we were lucky because, well, we were able to support it with those 5 people, and we had a great coaching. But I think... I mean, if you just be honest to yourself and are able to design based on first principles on like what is needed to build a company, I mean, you can find templates everywhere, then you are probably quite easily able to find the gaps, right? And I think that is one of the things that we at Leiter did early on already. Like we saw what we could not do ourselves and just find the people that were able to help us, whether it was a partner that was happy to support us, a coach, a professor here at the university, or a new employee. It was searching for the right people. And I think that, because I heard the question as well, it resonates a bit with this one about how you hire for the first lead or the first more senior person. I think someone of
you. Yeah, in the beginning, actually, Mike was eavesdropping already. So someone said, shall we do all of it ourselves, or do we have to delegate tasks?
Yeah, that was
at the beginning, but it costs money.
Yeah, like, and I think that is because you just don't need too many people, right? It's not that you immediately have to hire 100 senior people. You're probably able to find at least that one crazy person that does believe in your ID and is willing to decrease in salary and is just motivated by maybe a reward package based on shares and the motivation behind your product. And I think that what we noticed is that, especially in the beginning, we did make some adjustments in our salary system. I can't even call it a system. We just all had the bare minimum salary that we had to pay in Netherlands in order not to get into jail. that's what we did. But then for some senior people, of course, that was not enough, and we adjusted it. And everybody was just super happy with it. They were like, I'm so glad that this person joined. Please pay the amount that is needed. And then still it was low compared to the market. And what I notice is that because it's equal and everybody isn't there for the same reason, gets the same money, just adds the most value possible, there are quite some people that just want to work in such an environment. And I think it especially fits the kind of trend that we are in now, that people want to have more autonomy and more a purpose in their work. Yeah.
Instead of poen, as we call it in
money.
Dutch, like dough.
Yeah.
More purpose instead of poen.
Yeah.
That's a very good one. And then also be careful with assumptions like hiring extra expertise will cost me a fortune.
It
should not necessarily be the case. And especially I think something that Leiter did very well as well, because they were on the map as a student team because of all the publicity and everything, but also within this region, the Brainport region, they were really open and inviting all the people within their network. And
That is true. And even if you did not arise from any student team, then I mean you can participate in challenges, which you did a lot as well, and it helps you, of course, as this is actually learning how to pitch your product, meeting new people. You can sometimes earn quite some money that you can use to grow as a business. So just making sure that you have this network, and there's so many people that are willing to support a good business for just a little amount or maybe no amount of money. It's not that you ask the world to them. It's rather small usually.
Yeah. Anyone else, maybe from another startup, willing to ask a question from your own perspective, like how did Leiter dealt with it? Maybe you can learn from that. Feel free.
I'm actually a bit curious about the amount of co-founders. This is not very common, right, to have that many, like five.
Yeah.
And then when you were growing your company and you had to decide where to allocate the budget, where to hire more people or less, so these meetings, you mentioned something Dutch to find like a middle ground, right?
Yes, so it's called polderen.
Yeah, so it's always like this, like you always have these big meetings with this board of founders, and then you take all the decisions there. And I mean, just to be curious about the autonomy of each one of these co-founders.
I think that the founders had this, because they really truly believed in the principle of this autonomy and making decisions together. Almost never had the feeling that they had to make the decisions, and they tried to support actually the business to make the decisions. So what is needed for information or resources or whatever in order for the business to make a decision. And of course, sometimes you have the tough topics like indeed spending money or the strategy to go. And that was usually done having like some days together, spending with whiteboards all over the place, and then just drawing ideas. And they involved quite some others as well. So they understood that they did not have the full perspective at the table. So they involved others, and it was just more of a conversation and a brainstorm, where in the end, I think 99% of the time, the decisions were based on consensus. And then it was that they, well, just like voted or something like that. So thereby they knew that everybody was on board, and everybody was, well, when they left the room, everybody was, well, pushing the company the same direction. And I think that is great. We spent days, weeks in these kind of meetings, but still, I mean, today I had the strategy session, and I did not have it for, I think, maybe a year or something, like not at this kind of strategy session. And I was just opting random stuff, and we were still aligned because we used to have this so often that it's just clear for us which direction to go, even for the long term, especially for the long term, I must say. It's more easy than the short term sometimes. And the individual rights that a founder has, so to say, it's always double. So it's not that one founder can never sign off something, it's always a combination of two.
Two pairs of eyes. Yeah. Are you ready for this, Ricardo? Are you up for this, or do you think, oh, the Dutch Polder model?
No, it's just like a question, the last thing that you said about this finding two founders to sign something. Any two founders can constitute a pair of that? Or do you have founders that they are more technical and founders that they are more business side?
Back then it was any, but now it shifted. I think the founders can still sign, but usually business does. We are not really like a business that controls a lot. And sometimes that's a pitfall as well, because it sometimes is risky. But I think that for us, it was a bigger opportunity than it was at a risk, because it served us speed. Usually it was just two founders, and because they all wanted the same goal to serve and make sure that they did not sign something stupid, they would find the right person, right? I mean, you were not about to ask a commercial person to sign a technical document for any partner if you wanted to be checked properly. So yeah, they were able to find each other.
Even after all those iterations at Lightyear, there's still some logic behind it. Indeed. Definitely.
Hopefully there's even more than it was in the beginning.
Indeed. Is there anyone else willing to respond at this very point in the interview?
I was wondering what were the first processes you really formalized and advice to formalize for young companies?
Good one.
I think for us it was the onboarding and hiring process. Because what we actually believe is that you don't need processes, or try to limit the amount of processes, because if you have a proper culture, then it serves already quite a lot. However, it does not always work. For example, when we started having people getting in after our mission announcement, which was in 2017, summer 2017, we were with about 10 people, and we got like hundreds of applicants asking to join the company, and we were totally not prepared for it. And then we started setting up processes, but it was just like in the Google slide deck where we set up like, if you have someone applying, then take these steps, and you could click throughout the document, and then you could find like the questions you had to ask, or the contact details of the external recruiters who were helping us assigning the CV, so how do you say, the resumes. So it was a really light version, but those were the first processes. And then it was more the hiring process. And with regards to onboarding, I think that was one of the first ones that we spent quite some money on, in the way that we were really willing to pay for licenses that people could get to a digital onboarding program, and they could really learn about the Lightyear vision and what it means to work for Lightyear. And we really had a program there that they had to contribute to, and we had a budget that they could spend on on a challenge for Lightyear. So that was quite a big thing, actually, looking at the maturity of the organization. because in the end they had to build the organization, so we had to make sure that they truly understood what we were up to. And yeah, so that was, I think, the first few processes that we had.
Yeah, I've got a follow-up question on that, actually, because I have no idea, and it's a little bit beyond the theme of this one, but do you now have more cash to splash? And is it that you now take more liberties with granting opportunities or spending it more easily than before?
Yeah, we are spending,
tight?
I mean,
like crazy,
bigger amounts of money more easily compared to what we were used to. But it just changed, like the order of magnitude is shifting over time. And the amount of money that you get in, it reflects the amount of money that you spend as well. So it's way more than we were used to. And we have less time than we had in the beginning. So we usually say like we have time and money, and sometimes we have less money and then we spend more time, and sometimes we have less time and then we spend more money. And that's the kind of balance that we try to achieve. But over time we had ups and downs, and sometimes it felt comfortable and sometimes not. But I think that the main thing that we continuously tried to achieve is the speed, making sure that we were there, are still there as soon as possible, on the market, selling the car. And yeah,
it's planned for upcoming summer, isn't it?
Yeah,
summer 2022. Yeah. And you sold how many pre-orders already?
Oh, I have to check, but I think it's somewhere between 100 and 150 cars.
Yeah. And it's quite costly as well.
Yeah, it is. It is 150,000 euros.
Excluding VAT, isn't it?
Yeah.
So those are mostly like early adapters, entrepreneurs, believing in the vision, getting enthused by the story, because that's actually one question I have as well. But maybe first, before we go there, is there anyone in the room willing to question Maaike? Maybe Lee, you said in the preparing something about values as well. Maybe this is a good point to put that one forward, please.
Great story. Thanks so much for sharing. Was just interested to know how, in terms of building the culture also, what kind of values you're building around, how you bring those to life to build a consistent culture, and you know, to keep the culture along the lines of how you guys had it from day one, which is five of you, to today.
Yeah. Yeah, great question. Thanks. I think we started already quite early. I think when we were about 10 people, we started defining the values that we had.
What are some of them?
Yeah, those were changed. But for example, transparency was one of them.
Okay.
And what we had back then was that over time, when we were at about 80 people, we found out that we still valued the values, but people tend to interpret them differently. So for example, transparency or a flat structure, I think that was something that we mentioned explicitly. We noticed that, that we sometimes just were not able to live up to it in the way that people expected us to do so. So for example, we stated that high levels of transparency or a flat structure doesn't necessarily mean that there are no boundaries, which we in the beginning tried. So we said, okay, everybody can make any decision, and we thought that was the right way to go. And when we were about 20 people, people got confused, we're just waiting for each other, checking who's about to make the decision, and it was just a failure. And then what we actually noticed was when we provided some structure or some, clarity on this is the blank piece of paper, which is still huge, that you are allowed to work on, people felt even more freedom because they knew the freedom they could take in order to make their decisions. So what we noticed that we still valued that, but in a different way, and people had to perceive it differently. So what we did is we spent quite some time in redefining the values, which more or less was still linked to what we had in the beginning. And then we checked with the whole company, so with 80 people, we did questionnaires, we checked, we got all their feedback, we got back to people which feedback we did not include, so it was really like a personal thing. Everybody committed to the values, and still we have these values in place, and I think it's just because in the beginning we were not able to think properly about how do you formulate such a thing, and then we did, we got some help from an external person who was great at formulating things, which I am not, and so that was great, and we still have it.
For you personally, can you name some of them that are closest to your heart that you really believe in?
Yeah, all of them are, and I think that is the most easy thing to have, especially in the beginning. Lightyear, it just felt like just do what your heart tells you to do, or your mind, or whatever, at least your body. And it was so easy to make any decision. So we have think independently, making sure that, yeah, you come up with new solutions without reinventing the wheel that we stayed to.
Yeah.
Be bold, so dare to make bold decisions. We have a bold mission, so we need to. Deliver the change, so really deliver what you promise us to do. Put people first. We think that is important, not only because of the mission. We serve people all around the world and making sure that, yeah, that the people internally are put first as well. Think independently, put people first, deliver the change, be bold. And I think that one you still you'll still get from
you
me.
You can find it on the company website. That's also one takeaway. The human mind is actually better in remembering three instead of two or four or five. So maybe if you come up with a top three, that's also a good takeaway. But I didn't look into these. But
take responsibility.
Take responsibility. Excellent. Instead of shoving the task towards them, saying, look it up on the company side, you say take responsibility and you come up with it. I didn't look into them and I didn't ask you before, but bold, that was the one that I thought of immediately. Because when I saw Tessie Hartjes, I think she's also one of the first 10 employees. She came up with some LinkedIn post 5-6 years ago and she was in my network here at the University of Technology. And I thought, this is just such a big and bold and brave story.
Yeah.
Following up on the values is that, like, if you want to live them, also your skills have to match them, like to come up with them. And maybe this is a very good small little bridge towards the image which is now behind you, which is the revealing of the light year. I would love you to tell something about this, because you managed as light year to get like a crowd of CEO people of the Netherlands to a random location far away at this insane hour of the day. Can you please tell, because this is such a good example of attitude and the things you did, coming up with boldness.
Yeah, I think I have to give the credit to the marketing and sales and commerce.
Fair enough, you work together.
Because I think being bold really is something that they truly live up to. And for example, when getting funding in, that is something that, for me, sometimes felt uncomfortable. For me, it's more like being transparent and honest. I'm more like maybe on the humble side. And I think that serves when being like more internal focused, because people, what I tell to people, they want to believe me, and I want the same way.
Yeah.
But for like a marketing thing, it is more important actually to, like, we have all these crazy ideas and we have to try to translate at least a bit of them into something tactical that they really
graspable,
have a feeling with.
Yeah.
And then sometimes you have to maybe blow up a bit of your story. But for me, it sometimes might feel comfortable, but they are really good at it. Well, at actually telling the honest story, but like making it understandable to people.
Yeah.
And that's what they did here as well. So they had this great idea about that we had to present the lighter one, the final prototype, which we built like 3 years, because over these 3 years, people never got the possibility to see the car actually, but at our office. So if you was at our office, you were able to see it, but you had to like leave your phone behind.
I once was there. You had to put your mobile phone away, like
in a bag, seal it.
Yeah,
so it was like super
secretive.
Secret, yeah.
So a little transparency, but that came later. Yeah.
And the reason is that what we believed is that all people can build a mock-up and can design a nice car, but we wanted to show them that we actually were able to integrate the technology that we were developing and able to drive the car.
True.
So what we did is we invited all those people that were still waiting for that car, maybe already had bought it, they were able to invite their friends and family, because they got back home like, I said this great car, and then the family and friends were like, okay, do you have a picture?
So quickly, no. But these people have spent 150,000 euros, excluding VAT, on a car, and they hadn't had seen it yet.
Yeah, sometimes like some with the visuals, VR.
Yeah, all right, so they were invited and they were like thrilled to come over.
Yeah, they were invited at Sunrise. And a lot of credits to the commerce team again. But what they did not really well is that they organized it around like the longest day in the Netherlands. So that means that sunrise is pretty early here.
Dawn.
I think it's about like 4 or something.
In the morning, yeah.
Yeah, so 4 in the morning and everybody had to be at that location. So we had like all those people driving in the dark, entering, and indeed it were all like CEO people. And then there was this moment that it was actually quite cloudy. So we were like, yeah, and then it had to be like the theater stage, it could open up like the doors to the outside
doors,
actually.
Yeah, yeah.
And then we would show like the larger one there finally present and then driving on stage. That was the idea. And then what actually turned out is what you can see in the back is that at that specific moment, the light of, so I'm getting a chicken pox.
Goosebumps.
Goosebumps.
Yeah.
The sun was actually shining on the car. So that was, for us, it was really a statement, of course, because it was a solar car. It would have been awesome anyway, but it was just great that the sun was just shining on the car and it was able to drive in there. And then we made this little joke as well, because we had this surf dude in the car, getting out of the car with his nice swimming pants on, and then he just grabbed his surfboard out of the car just to show like the luggage space that we had. Yeah, it was a great moment.
Awesome, awesome. It's still on YouTube, so if you are gonna Google and you will see the CEO, Lex, who is a very young guy, still around his 30s.
Yeah.
And this brings me actually to the next question, because by building such successful organizations and by reeling in other people, what do you think as well for the people in the call should be true soft skills that you actually should have as the launching people of like the startup team? Like, mm-hmm. You can be on the technology side, you can code, you have all the hard skills in the world, but how can you reel in other people? What would you say?
That's a good one. Yeah, that is difficult, because I think that for every individual it might be different, but I think for me personally it is being honest to yourself and to others.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're honest to yourself, you know your pitfalls, you can work on them, you can improve them, or you might decide that that's just not the way to go because you are unable or unwilling to improve them. And being honest to others, I think, helps a lot as well in truly listening to them, what they want, so that you can provide support. And as well, even if support sometimes might feel not giving any positive news, which sometimes is, I mean, we have had these cases as well. I knew, yeah, someone was really hoping for something or wanted to achieve something. And I truly felt like, yeah, but if I am truly honest with you, it's just that I don't believe that you're up to it and I have to share it. And then he or she can, well, share his or her thoughts, like I can improve or I can't. But that's the only way that you have a fair discussion and you can grow. So I think honesty for me is the one single soft skill
and
that
leads towards true listening, as you said as well. Yeah, yeah,
yeah.
Cool. Is there anyone willing to ask anything for Mike? For this last bit, we've got a full open Q&A, so feel free to ask something. And in the meantime, I would like to add on that is like the storytelling, maybe done by Lex, you know, he's so able to tell the story on several levels, like on the abstract level for the bigger purpose of the world, but then probably also within the company to induce people to work a little bit longer or harder in order to get it done before the opening is, obviously.
Yeah.
Also a very good one. Yeah. Any questions, additions, remarks?
Mike, where is the car built?
At this moment, the prototype was built in Helmond. So that's the automotive campus that was really referring to. But we are outsourcing actually the production of the car to Valmet, which is a partner in Finland. They are going to produce the cars for us.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so because you've had pre-purchases, you've had the cash to enable you to do that?
Yeah, you could say cash to enable, but it's more, I think, not having cash to do it ourselves. In the beginning, we actually thought that we would build the first cars ourselves, but it is a way too high investment. And I think now it fits better in the strategy because we want to ramp up more quickly than we expected to. But some years ago, we still thought that we would have to, and then we found out that the amount of investment just simply did not suit the business case.
So you've had to partner?
Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you.
Good one, yeah.
I have a small question, if possible. Thank you for this interesting story.
Gijs also asked it in the chat, I think, but we are really starting, we just started 2 months ago.
Yeah.
How did you start in the first phase with financing or searching for investors?
We organized the Family, Friends and Fools evening. I don't know if you're familiar with the terminology, but it is the FFF, the Family, Friends and Fools. It's just like the people around you that are willing to jump in. But we did not call it, of course, because then people were doubting whether they were one of them. We don't want them to have the idea that they are a fool. So we called it Investor Cafe. And then we invited just people and at a just a nice place. We told our story. We had some drinks together. And then we clearly asked. So it was something that we, that's something that we actually learned quite soon. You really have to ask for money. Like people are not going, sometimes they do. But if you like stay there on the stage, explain your vision and people think, ah, that's a nice story. Let's have a drink. That's it. Then you won't get money at that kind of evenings. But we clearly asked like, this is what we need, the amount of money that we need to achieve a particular goal. And we would like to ask you to think about whether you want to participate. It already can start. I think then it was with 100 euros or something, because we had like to pay just for rent and the rent of the
This is actually also skill, because in the south of the Netherlands, we tend to be a little bit humble. Maybe we can be too humble, but asking for money on its own is actually a skill. There used to be a very famous comedian in the Netherlands, and he had a sketch saying la 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 geld, like la 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 money. That doesn't do the job either. So you have to have the story and you have to have the skill for asking for money, because without either one of them.
Yeah, that is true. At least your call of action should be clear, right? Yeah. And then it's up to people to decide for themselves whether they feel comfortable doing it or not doing it.
Yeah. And their checklist is what I found out as well myself is, do they believe in it? And is it fueling them with energy? So if those two are correct for investors, at what level for every human being do I believe in your story? And is it fueling me with energy?
Yeah.
I think if you have those people on board, they become your ambassadors.
Yeah, and that's an interesting one, because fueling with energy can be either from your business idea or concept, but it could be as well like the community that they can get part of. Because if there are more investors and they just like to have a chat together with each other, they're getting part of this kind of network, they just like to be there, and you invite them for this drinks or whatever inspiration evening, and they will meet each other, and that can be a reason for people to join as well. I think that was one way to get it. So from the Family, Friends and Fools, we had subsidiaries, how do you say it,
the money subsidized.
From a government. And the challenges. So we, what I said, we participated, for example, in Philips Innovation Awards and that kind of stuff. And then sometimes we won, sometimes we did not. And that, it helps. I think it was quite okay. If you have a clear story, you don't need that much, right? So, and just don't try to get all money in for upcoming 2 years. Just build on top.
Investors also want to know what you're going to do with the money instead of stacking it in a bank account.
Yeah.
Time's flying by, 46 minutes in.
Oy.
So we have a few minutes extra just to wrap it up. Maybe there's one small, short little question by one of you, and otherwise I will be eyeing to Maaike if you've got some takeaways, a shout out message, because we've been dealing with organizational structure, motivating people, changing the organizational structure, talking about values, coming up with anecdotes, it's full. Is there still something left on the table that we still want to share?
Yeah, I just want to check, because none of you have asked, like, did I answer your question? So if there's still people that have the feeling that I did not, then just please shout out. And if you might think about it later and still have questions, then feel free to reach out to me if you want to.
Maaike Reserveur, yeah. Thank you so much. I actually want to thank all of you for joining in this call.
I
definitely.
Think Gijs,
what if Tesla comes around? And I cannot see the entire message. So maybe Mark, maybe you can help us out. And is offering $1 billion. What is the rest of the message? What if Tesla comes around the corner with a massive offer? What would you do?
That depends on what the offer is about. If the massive offer includes achieving our mission faster than we could do ourselves, then we might consider it.
Yeah.
If we have the idea that they do it just because to get ourselves out of the market, then we absolutely won't.
Yeah. Good one. And dear people, be careful what you wish for, because I did speak to some very successful entrepreneurs before, and they got their buyout when they were 29 years of age, and they bored themselves to death because they had 26 million euros in the bank, but they didn't have any friends to spend it with because they were all just working. Yeah.
Yeah, I think that I like you that we work hard, but we value friendships and some spare time as well.
Awesome. So, yeah. That is a cool sentence to wrap it up with. Mike, Reisver, thank you so much for coming over for this 45 minutes. And especially for all the people in the call, we will see you another time for another Boost interview. And for once more, I would love to ask you to unmute yourself, all of you, for the last time and give a big round of applause for Mike. Thank you very much, all of you. My name is Rudy, and I'll see you next time. Have a good one. Cheers from Eindhoven. Bye.
Bye-bye.